Walk through the building, it's an amazing place. We've walked through what is actually quite a large gallery space. There's a room upstairs where you write and, and work. And now we're actually in the place where you throw pots.
Yes.
This is actually quite a modest space compared to the others. What is it that you need as a as an artist and a potter to work?
Almost nothing. I mean, that's the complete joy. I mean, this space is something that, that anyone who makes pots would understand and would have understood for a thousand years. So, I mean, all I actually need, you know, is a wheel, you know, and water and clay.
Yeah.
And then, you know, three tools, really, you know, a piece of wood and a knife. Where's my knife? Knife and a, you know, and a sponge, and that, you know, that that's it. So it's actually pretty immediate in terms of sort of hands and material and space. So, you know, I don't need a huge, grandiose space. And actually, it's actually very nice to work with this sort of sense of focus. Having done this for 45 out of my 50 years, is that actually still, you know, picking up a piece of clay, thumping it down on the wheel, you know, bringing it into the centre and making a vessel, it's still very compelling for me. It's sort of, it, you know, it's, it still has a very strong rhythmical kind of focus to me, which actually makes sense.
You mentioned the clay. I mean, I've got a piece of my
Head
here.
Yeah.
In the book, you talk about the two different types of material that come together to make porcelain clay.
Yeah.
And of course, now you have it very handily pre-mixed in a bag. But I think almost anybody will remember from childhood that thrill of grabbing a piece of Play-Doh or plaster of Paris, getting your hands dirty. That's what it feels like very much, but it's a very tactile material.
It's astonishingly tactile. I mean, there is a sort of inexhaustible quality to it, which is really amazing. I mean, the fact is that, you know, you take a bit in your hands and you keep on working with it between your fingers, and it just gets thinner and thinner and thinner and thinner until you think it's just going to float away. And of course, when it's fired, you know, this extraordinary material lets light through. It's one of those miraculous materials which is like that, but can be translucent. I mean, how does that work? So, you know, so it's, and because it's white, this ridiculous purity, of course, that anything around it can contaminate it. So, so everything, you're hyper aware of everything that surrounds it, because you know, everything that comes into this clay will be revealed later on when it comes out the kiln.
Right.
And any mistake, of course, will be punished, which is what the kiln does.
Well, you're saying, because when it's a soft material, it's incredibly tactile, and you can make it do almost anything.
Yeah.
But
if
the result of that is that when you put it into the kiln, as you say, any imperfection will suddenly become very, very apparent.
Yeah.
And it undergoes this radical transformation inside the kiln.
I mean, one of the strangest things, of course, is for me, is it's on this journey, you know, from China all the way through this extraordinary sort of series of landscapes of porcelain, is at every point finding the things that have gone wrong, you know, picking up broken bits of porcelain from different landscapes all the way along the line. And of course, brokenness, broken things, things that have gone wrong, you absolutely feel the immediacy of someone. You feel real kinship and friendship across these centuries with people who've made things that have gone disastrously wrong, because that's what still happens to me.
Mm. You mentioned that there's that kind of, it's almost like a quest for perfection, isn't it? As you're trying to, for the characters in the book, I say characters, of course they're real people, but you know, you feel like you get to know them just like characters in a book, and they are trying to make the perfect porcelain clay. They're trying to make the perfect vase or bowl.
Yeah.
You, as you said, you've been doing this for 45 of your 50 years. There is something, I think it's almost like a metaphor for any artistic pursuit, which is that you're looking for perfection, but because there is no such thing really as perfection, there is always elements failing on the way. It felt very much like it sort of applies to almost any artistic pursuit.
Well, it is in that sense of, you know, exactly. I mean, it's a very, it's what you read through porcelain, what you read through this material is this, this need to try and make a space in your life, make a space which, where something works in the world, where you can look at something and stand by it and it's got beauty and some kind of presence.
Mm.
And that's all you want to do. But at every point along the way, you're beset by things that stop that happening or damage it. And so, yes, it's a very real and humane path. It's not, and it's an obsessional path. You know, it's, it, you know, it takes you over. in that sense. Am I allowed to make something? Well, I'm much easier to talk when I'm actually making something.
Absolutely, yeah. Making yeah. and breaking. And
yeah.
The thing about
yeah.
finding a shard of
yeah.
of porcelain
yeah.
and being able to sort of look at it and, yeah. and see the glaze and see the structure of it.
Yeah.
And that was how yeah. many people were trying to work out how to recreate porcelain when they didn't know how it was made. Is that right?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, so people... When there's this marvellous sort of journey through people actually breaking pots,
mm.
you know, not only just finding shards and broken pots and then picking them up and trying to analyse them, but actually there's this wonderful Devonian apothecary, mm. William Cookworthy, who was known as this wonderful letter for snapping people's porcelain. He'd sort of quietly take a piece of Chinese porcelain off the table during the dinner
yeah.
and snap it, just to have a look at the kind of, at the structure of porcelain. And that idea of making through breaking
yeah.
is something that is very appealing. And actually, when I was writing the book, I had this very strong visual image of fragments of a not only of a hillside of fragments, you know, a great, enormous Chinese hillside with broken shards,
mm.
but actually of a when I wrote the book, actually I wrote it almost like a series of shards. So all my chapters are, I have lots of shard-like chapters,
mm.
65 bits of text
yeah.
all next to each other. So it's like a hillside. Well, I don't know, it sounds very. But that's how I thought.
Yeah, no, it is yeah. absolutely. Yeah. You get the sort of. The story is fragmented, as
yeah.
you say, and what it does is it comes together to make a sort of very coherent story as you go through the book. So even though we're talking about shards of text and
yeah.
different, it feels very coherent by the time you get to the end. You feel like you've, well, I mean, I felt a material which I hadn't thought about
yeah.
once in my life
yeah.
suddenly became fascinating. I was looking at plates and bowls completely differently.
Snapping them, I hope.
Well, I have a pretty good track record of doing that, naturally.
Yeah.
But of course, you know, the stuff yeah. I have is very cheap. You realise the difference between what most of our plates and bowls look like and the difference between that and real amazing porcelain.
Well, you know, it's so strange because, of course, one of the miraculous things about this is this is everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, Chinese porcelain ends up, you know, in fragments in East Africa,
mm-hmm.
you know, and Yemeni sheikhs 1,000 years ago were buying it, and it's all the way along the Silk Road. But then it's also in, you know, in bits of sort of colonial America. Mm. They try and make this porcelain, and it's obviously deeply embedded in Europe as well. And then it's also, you know, and then it's here we are in. Wherever we are, West Norwood in South London, next to the
yeah.
bus garage, just out there, and I'm still making porcelain.
Yeah.
So in that sense, you know, it's you know, it has that stretch into people's lives across a ridiculous amount of time.
Mm. It is, as I said, completely fascinating and amazing to watch you talking about it and making it
well,
with amazing ease.
All I'm making is a few very simple. Vessels here, which for an installation, for a group of work
mm.
that I'm making for something later this year, but you know, but actually returning to the clay, you know, picking it up, feeling the weight of it,
mm.
and then sort of beginning to make a volume, you know, is very much it's the thing I do.
Edmund, we're now in a different part of your
yeah.
studio,
yeah.
and one thing that's very clear from reading the book is that. Breaking is almost as important as making
Absolutely,
in
yes.
that pursuit
yes.
for porcelain.
Yeah.
You make pots all the time mm. and you break them all the time, which sort of breaks my heart.
Well, you know, you can't let things go out into the world if they're not right.
Yeah.
You know, and so, you know, you pick up a pot from the kiln and, you know, the glaze isn't quite right. Celadon pot, porcelain, little chip there.
Mm.
You know, so, you know, what do you do? Well, and that just shows you how well made it is.
That is
there you
extraordinary.
Go. So there you go. Have it. Piece of broken porcelain.
I've got my own
make me your shard collection.
Edmund De Waal, thank you so much.
That's a huge pleasure. Thanks, Will.